Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to a wet and wild night. I am Jason Agnew here with Bob Gifford, getting ready to call the game between the Moncton Mustangs and the Southern New Brunswick Ducks. Bob, this should be a pretty interesting game, don't you think?
Yeah, you know, the Mustangs are going to be looking for that first W after dropping a game last weekend in St. John to the Wanderers. And the Ducks are also 0-1 at this point after losing to PEI in St. John last weekend to the Island Mariners.
So we've got two teams both looking for their first win. It should really be an interesting game. They're getting ready to get set at the midfield for the coin toss and the captain introductions. But we can talk a little bit about maybe some of the teams that we're going to be, or some of the players we're going to be looking at. You know, for the Mustangs, we know we have lots of veterans, including, you know, quarterback Dan Comfort, as well as Bobby McIntyre, who's a 13-year sort of veteran who's played both in Moncton as well as in Fredericton and played in Acadia as well. And we're also looking for some, you know, lots of different players, including, you know, Joel Ricard. We have lots of different players.
It's open just above the end zone.
And for the Southern New Brunswick Ducks, it's a little different because there's a lot of names we haven't really seen before, and Bob and I have both been around this league for a long time. But we are seeing a few different ones. I know, Bob, we were talking about, I believe it was the center for Southern New Brunswick who played with the Wanderers for many years and was oftentimes an all-star or a perennial all-star. So it should be sort of one of those interesting ones where, you know, there's not a lot of film on the Ducks yet, so it's really kind of hard to play against them.
Yeah, we're going to find out a lot about them quickly here once the game starts, but there are some names on there that are familiar. Another notable one that isn't a player, but the president is Darcy Barker, who's a former Longhorn, a team that was around for a number of years when the league first started, and now they've moved. He's moved into the front office with the Ducks.
All right, so it looks like you know, the toss is gone, and they're about to decide. So we can see that as the referee's deciding what he's going to do. And Curtis Nicholson was the player I was discussing. So the Mustangs will be receiving, and it looks like Southern New Brunswick will be kicking off. So we'll be getting ready pretty quickly. Again, on a wet day like this today, Bob, is there anything extra that people have to deal with or worry about?
Well, unfortunately, it's not only wet, but it's also cold. So that combination will be a bit of a challenge. But these are all guys that have played in the Maritimes and have played late fall games. So I don't think it'll be too much of a challenge. Maybe some of the players from out of town will find it more challenging.
And we were sort of discussing that a little bit, that we always talk about summer football, and it really hasn't been a lot of summer football yet. But hopefully pretty soon we'll be able to see a little bit of sun and see the teams playing sort of in mid-afternoon. So it looks like the teams are getting ready, and I believe they're going to be playing O Canada.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise and remove your caps for our national anthem.
Okay, and now after the national anthem, both teams are getting ready. You know, now all the planning is done, and now it's just about the execution. One of the hardest things as a coach, and I know Bob and I have both coached as well, is once the play starts, it's really difficult to just stand back and let the players do it. But that's, I think, one of the best parts of the sport is we always say on any given Sunday, well, we'll go on any given Friday here. So, again, the Mustangs ready to return. Returner back there is number 14, Akeem White. And the kicker for the Ducks is number 7, Okie Kepanek. So we're getting ready for the kickoff. Again, one of the tricky parts about a game like this, because it's wet and cold, that ball can be slipping around everywhere, and we've got to be careful if you're trying to return it. Wouldn't you say, Bob?
Absolutely. I'm sure Coach Terrace took a minute to talk to his return man and emphasize that we can make up field position, but if we don't catch this ball cleanly and turn it over, it can be cause a lot of problems. So here we go.
Okay, so it goes in. White's moving up. Looks like he has an open lane. Does have some speed, but it looks like he's going to be shot out of bounds by number 23. And that would be Jake Miller. So it gets him out at about the 30, looks like the 39-yard line, which is a nice place to start if you're the Moncton Mustangs and their offense, led by Dan Comfort.
It'll be first down for the Mustangs on the Ducks.
That was a great play on that ball. It hung up in the wind a little bit. He was able to get under it, catch it cleanly, and found a seam.
And again, that's one of the best parts or most interesting parts of playing 10-man football is there are a lot more seams, so with athletes there, you can really move. So Mustangs come out with, as we can see, sort of just a basic sort of pistol formation. Lots of motion. Straight handoff directly to Aubrey Ellis. Straight up the middle. Hard running for about 14, 15 yards. There is a player down. So that was a pretty solid sort of, you know, run by Hicks. By Aubrey Ellis. I'm trying to see the number. It looks like 23.
Might be 33.
Is it 33? That
I think that's a fullback.
So that'd be Alex Doyle.
Yeah.
So went down. I'm not really sure what it is, but as we can see, you know, as he went down, you know, this is where it's really good to have, you know, a good size O-line, which Moncton does have, and really to be able to drive people back there. So everyone's going to be sort of ready and looking.
Not sure what the injury is.
Yeah, it was hard to see, you know, and sometimes it's hard. It might be, well, he's taken his helmet off, so it might have been, you know, either a finger in the eye or you know, something. It's really hard to tell. Doesn't seem to be anything sort of lower body, which we normally will see. You don't see him sort of rolling around, so it is a hard one.
He may have had the wind knocked out of him.
And again, that's one of those difficult things when it's a cold night like tonight, to really be able to sort of move around and try to stay warm. You know, when a player goes down like that, you got to make sure you can get someone. So we do see him stretching his leg out a bit. It might have even been sort of a hamstring or something like that. So again, you know, on cold nights like this can be sort of difficult. Because we need to make sure that everyone is sort of safe, and you're trying not to push yourself too much on the first play, I guess. But Mustangs will be getting ready. The referee will blow the whistle in a moment. We'll be starting with another first down. Again, you know, the Mustangs' bread and butter from the time you were playing was always sort of power running, and I think we'll probably see the same, but you never know. Offensive coordinator Fran Best likes to kind of gamble a little bit and keep the defense off on their heels a little bit and sort of off kilter.
Yeah, absolutely. This kind of weather lends itself to power running.
So now we got sort of, you know, trips to one side, and we see a lot of movement. So, oh, look, quick pass. Oh, and a quick drop, just a little bit over his head, and it's a little hard when you have this wet weather. That was number 9. Leslie Green, who just a little bit out of his reach, and again, that's sort of what you want to do is kind of keep the defense off balance a little bit and just take a shot every once in a while and have them sort of back up so that you can, again, sort of pound that rock a little bit more.
Yeah, Comfort throwing to one of his favorite targets and throwing it in a way that only Green was going to catch that ball. So it's a good way to stretch the defense a little bit early on.
So we now have number 99, Brandon Caldwell, in at fullback. And again, we'll see. I don't think we're going to see him get his hands on an offside on the right guard. That would be number 63. That would be Evan Melanson. So again, you know, that's the hard part sometimes is whether The cadence gets changed up, or he's just looking at driving down a little bit, and that'll drop them back another five. But they still got really good field position, so you'll see them kind of pushing. And again, because we play four down football, it's not as much of an urgent point right now.
Yeah, they can make this up, no problem.
So, nice pass or nice run. Looks like another first down, or if not, really close. That was number 31, I believe. That was Brady Morris. Brady Morris is actually a rookie. He's originally with the Riverview Royals. One of the things that Moncton has done a really good job of, they have several sort of running backs that they can use, which as an offensive coordinator is always good because you're always keeping fresh and you don't have to worry about riding that single horse all the time.
Yeah, and you get a change of pace when you change guys, and he followed his blocks really well on that one, didn't get contacted until about 10 yards downfield.
And we see that now because we now have a different running back, a lot more speed, Cam Morley, and it looks like he's going to be in for a touchdown. Sweep right, and Cam, who plays at Acadia, just has that extra gear that you kind of like to see in a football player, especially an offensive football player. But the blocking there was also, pretty spot on, so...
Yeah, no doubt. I think he's obviously very fast, and he made that look easy, but the blocking was outstanding. I think a lot of people could have scored on that.
Yeah.
For Francis Best, the offensive coordinator, that's the way he drew it up, and that's the way they did it, and that feels good.
And that's, yeah, I think you made a really good point there, is that, when the play is drawn out right, it makes it, everyone looks good when they do it right. So the PAT about to be attempted by Ben George. This is Ben's second year. He's actually with the Acadia Axemen right now. And he gets the single point. Ben is one of those players that has what we like to call sort of a leg. And he had in several PATs last year. He was actually hitting what they call the goalpost lounge, and he was hitting it over the roof. So that's a pretty tough one to deal with. But as we saw in that replay there, just everything drew up perfectly. And then when you have someone with that much speed, they can fly right through. All right, so now Moncton will be getting ready to kick off. Again, we'll see Ben George, and really the hope you would think now is you want to try to pin the Ducks back and make them worried about it. And there's also lots of spots within that field that if that ball goes bouncing around, it's anyone's ball.
Yeah, and the Mustangs kickoff team will know that. Ben will be looking to kick it deep. The wind is with them, so they know that there's a chance that ball will be bouncing around when they get there, and it's a live ball for everybody.
And again, this is one of those interesting ones where there's a lot of speed there. So George on his way up, just booming kick. He's going to hit probably about the 10-yard line. Again, nothing better than having a kicker with that kind of leg. Really setting up. Nice block up the middle. And looks like tackle was by number 7, Jerome Shimpangila, a rookie. He's playing actually with the Holland Hurricanes right now over on PEI with the AFL. Nice little tackle there and a nice little return of about, 25, 30 yards. So that's a good way. That's the Ducks, I'm sure, are happy not to be pinned back on their 10-yard line because that field looks a lot longer, especially in weather like this.
Yeah, on the road, in the rain, cold, it's a tough start.
All right, so the Mustangs defense is coming out for the first time, and the Ducks offense, so we'll see kind of what's going on. We can see with the Ducks, they've got some good size offensive linemen. Looks like they've got quads over on the right-hand side, really to try to throw the Mustangs off. So we'll soon see what happens here, whether they're able to actually move anything. And there was a timeout just taken out. Looks like there was a personnel problem. From what I could see, there was no end on the other side. And I think they called the timeout just to try to maybe fix things up. I think they were trying to throw the Mustangs off a little bit, maybe see how they were going to respond to some strange sort of formation.
You can see the DBs here are clustered up, discussing how they're going to approach that formation if it comes up again, and that's a great opportunity for them to get a sneak peek of what's coming.
Right, and it is a tough one because now you have those four receivers there, and we've got to make sure that no one's getting sort of free rein. So oftentimes you'll see them sort of box, a smart offense coordinator is going to set those receivers up there and possibly just run to the other side where there's more space. Again, this is 10-man football, so of course you do have a lot more space. So now the Ducks are coming out in much more of a traditional sort of offense, just with a single back and two receivers on each side, as well as a wing back. So we'll see if there's a, you know, going to be a pass or a run first. Okay, so a straight dive, straight up the middle. Looks like their fullback, Justin Ellingwood. From what I can tell, these numbers are a little hard to see, but we'll do our best to try to get them get the right numbers, because I'm sure those guys would want to have them called the same way as well. But that was a nice sort of power run, you know, another 4 or 5 yards.
It'll be 7-5.
Again, with those sort of four down football, if you can keep kind of pulling away sort of four downs or 4 or 5 yards each play, that does make things much easier. All right, again, so it looks like now straight up the middle and taken down, but looks like after first down. So, again, the Ducks have come out and shown that they've got some athletes and are able to sort of move the ball around a little bit.
Yeah, and it looked like we had a couple of O-linemen pull on that play. So their O-line is looking big and athletic at this point.
Which is something a defense never really likes to look at, because if you have both big and athletic, it's very difficult to see. And it's kind of hard to move around with those guys. So now we're seeing a little bit of, a different sort of formation, a much smaller sort of running back in the back, so you're probably looking at either passing or much more of a straight up. And looks like he was taken down pretty much right there by number 91. So that was Felix LeBlanc, and there was a host in there, as well as number 22, Dave Cuthbertson. Dave is a rookie, has played out in Fort Mac with the Fort Mac Monarchs, as well as the GTA All-Stars, and has won several sort of national championships, and his work has taken him down here, so he's offered to kind of work with the team, and has been a real great addition to the Mustangs defense. Oh, fumble by the quarterback. Again, that's that wet ball that we're always talking about, that it's really dangerous. So we can see he's sort of taken down pretty quickly by 91. Again, Felix LeBlanc. But you live and die by the shotgun sometimes, and when that ball comes flying back, if your hands aren't perfectly dry, you're going to find out pretty quickly.
Yeah, so we had a couple of good runs, a stop, and then they went into shotgun, and now they find themselves in third and long. So it's a passing down for sure here.
So, yeah, so we're third and 25 almost. So Jared Lamming is going to have to really try to pull something out and try to hit an open receiver, and hopefully get some space. Uh-oh, looks like another mistake. Looked like a quarterback going the wrong way. It was brought down by number 50. That would be Blake Allain. Blake has been with the team for 4 years. He actually won a championship with the Mustangs 3 years ago. Blake is another one of those guys that has lots of speed. And this is what will happen sometimes, as we can see in the replay, just quarterback turned the wrong way or the running back went the wrong way. It's kind of hard to tell sometimes. So in cases like that, the quarterback did all that he could and just tried to at least not lose too many yards. So we can see they're now ready to kick it off. And again, their punter slash kicker is O.K. Kepenyak. And we do have, can't see right now, but we'll see who's going to return for the Mustangs. So nice little kick. So that would be 88, Cam Morley. Again, who's a big returner, has got a lot of speed. And has an okay return, but I'd say that was pretty good for the Ducks to be able to not give up too many yards on that one. And they really sort of cinched in and stopped him before he broke into open field.
Yeah, that ball hung up, and Cam did a good job of getting it quickly, but the Mustangs held their blocks as best they could, but the Ducks, I'd say, would be happy with that.
And now we've got, and again, this is interesting, where, you know, we have Canadian football, so the field's a little bit bigger, but we're still on the Duck side of the 50-yard line or 55-yard line. You know, little bumble pass, wide open receiver, number 14, Keem, still fighting for more, and finally taken out of bounds at about the 18-yard line. It looks like that was a blown coverage there, because no one was near him. And I can say if that snap had been directly in Dan's hands, that would have been a touchdown right there.
That play, like, they ran that play quickly after they got to the line. So I think they saw something last series they wanted to take advantage of, maybe someone walking to their coverage zone a little slow.
So, and you know, it's just like every other sport. If you can get the ball into your athlete's hands, that's always the positive thing. And White definitely has a lot of speed, and he has some pretty solid hands. So you know, something's going on there that, you know, Moncton's now going to try to take advantage of, you know, spots or weaknesses that they see in the defense?
Comfort's a... He's a veteran quarterback, and he's smart. And he'll spot that stuff really quick.
Yeah, and you know, Dan's played everywhere from Mount A as well as to Cégep in Quebec, as well as Matthew Martin, so he's a homegrown product. I was fortunate enough to coach him for several – well, not really coach him, really just give him the ideas. Ellis straight up the middle. And touchdown for Aubrey Ellis, as we can see there. Great blocks by Moncton. And then just letting Aubrey sort of cut. That's one of Ellis's strengths, is he's really, you know, it's again, it's not one that you can coach. He is a cutback runner, and he's just going to find sort of those open spots and put his foot into the ground and kind of move his way. As we can see here in the replay, just beautiful block by 99, Brandon Caldwell, to really set that up, and then the rest of it was Ellis.
And sorry.
Oh, no, go ahead.
We had three DBs who were given pursuit that underestimated his speed and the burst, and he just walked past them to the end zone. Made it look easy.
Yeah, and you can only rely on instincts so much here. It is all about angles in a game like this. And again, sometimes with games like this and weather like this, we do have a problem that if it's a bad snap or an off snap, you know, you're going to have to be moving a little bit. That was not a planned play by any stretch of the imagination.
Well, the refs are doing the best to keep that ball dry. You can see they're wearing towels, but...
Well, there's only so much you can do. As we can see, the rain has not stopped coming down. And they will have usually two per game, but they can also request an extra one. They'll usually switch it at halftime. But if the ball, and we know what those balls are like, pretty quickly once they get wet, the grip goes pretty quick,
yeah,
and it's hard to hold on to.
Once they get slippery, they stay that way.
All right, so the Mustangs getting ready to kick off again. Ben George will hopefully try to, you know, kick it deep again, or try to find an open spot and let the speed on his kickoff team really kind of go after the ball, and maybe even try to get it themselves. Right, so ref's about to blow it in. As we can see, like, George has a pretty big leg, and we can see he's sort of kicking it deep and to the right. Hoping to try to slow down a little bit of speed. It was a hard hit there, but good solid return by number 23. That would be Jake Miller. Again, picked his spots as much as he could, caught it about the 10, and was able to make it up to about the 27. So that's anytime you can get positive yardage on a kick return is a positive thing, I think.
Now we see the Ducks offense come out. It's halfway through the first quarter. They're down by two scores, and here's where we get to see what they're made of.
Absolutely, and this is the tough one. So now... And the Mustangs, you know, if they want, can really sort of pin their ears back and really kind of go after and try to pressure the quarterback. So we'll see sort of sweep on the outside. Now, there is a flag on the play. Kind of hard to see what it was for, but I think it looked like the end on the left-hand side of the Ducks moved before the ball was snapped, so we're probably going to see an offside. An illegal procedure, but we'll wait. Oh, no, so they're calling offside on Moncton, so it could have been one of the D linemen.
Yeah, I did see the right defensive end jump. I don't know that he was in the neutral zone, but the refs have a much better view than I do.
Absolutely, absolutely. So that'll move them up five, and the Ducks will take that every time we can.
And they're testing the outside on that run play. That's a new one.
And corners never like that, because when they keep trying to go to the outside, you're just saying that I don't think you can stop our running backs. So now we have a single back, and we're going to see a possible throw here, or straight up the middle. So now where the pressure really is on the linebackers now. So that run again by 22 is Ryan Fleming. So, you know, you're trying to really kind of jam it up the middle a little bit and try to tire out those defensive linemen who are pretty big and pretty strong. We think of, you know, players like 96 Ben Dunston, who's not a small fellow by any stretch of the imagination. So if you can really sort of tire those guys out, it really does help your offense later on in the game.
Absolutely. And I think it was a bit of a delayed handoff there, maybe a run-pass option.
So tackle there by number 16, Cameron Bell. Cam actually played at McNaughton here in his high school and is now playing for the Acadia Axemen. But we can see now another first down. And again, we can see we can see how important those sort of penalties are, because that 5 yards all of a sudden just gives them just an easier chance. Now you only need 2 or 3 yards per play as opposed to 5 or 6.
Yeah, and they're having some success running the middle, so that a penalty like that just makes it easy for the offensive coordinator to pick up a few yards through the middle of the defense.
So, and yet we're still seeing that same sort of idea where they're just going to keep running up the middle. We do see a flag on the play. Most likely going to be a hold. Yep, and it is a hold on the Ducks, so that'll go back 10 yards most likely. They didn't really catch them behind the line, so Mustangs will most likely take it and try to put them at first and 20.
Yep.
And really, you know, put the pressure onto them now to make another 20 before they can get another first down.
Yeah, hopefully take that interior run off the table. The running back had to make a cut that I don't think he was anticipating, so I think probably one of the Mustangs D-line either stunted or defeated the block, forcing him to go outside, and that caused the hold. So,
and that's exactly what you want to do as a defense, is the more you can throw the running backs and the timing off, especially on those interior run plays. So we have some speed and some strength on the line of the Mustangs, and they're trying to do everything they can. So now an attempt at a run, and it looks like a sack by number 16, Cameron Bell again. So just a straight up blitz up the middle. It wasn't really even on to the side, and it was hard to tell, but it looked like the quarterback was almost, it was a planned sort of draw or run play for the quarterback, and I think there was so much pressure that he wouldn't have had time to throw anyways.
Yeah, he got there around the same time as the ball.
So now again, the problem that we run into sometimes when penalties go like that, we're now looking at first and or second and almost 30. So that can be a lot more daunting of a play. Again, we're seeing that attempt at a pass and another fumble, or sorry, pardon me, another sack again by number 16, Cam Bell, as well as 96, Ben Dunston. The two of them were in there, taking them back. So now it'll be third and almost 40, and now the Mustangs are really starting to put the pressure on.
Well, we're seeing this Mustangs defensive line and linebackers, when they get the Ducks into whatever down and long situation, they're attacking. They're not thinking about stopping the interior run.
And it's a 3-2 defense, so now you already have sort of numbers off. So again, they're trying to get outside. And beautiful tackle by number 6, Bobby McIntyre, to stop again that outside run. McIntyre is a wily veteran of many years. Again, as I said, playing first with the Junior Raiders here in Moncton, and then the Mustangs, as well as the Fredericton Gladiators before they stopped operations. And Bobby did exactly what you're supposed to do as that corner. He just set himself up, ready for the tackle, didn't try to be a hero, and took him down.
Yeah, he made a nice tackle, and if he had missed, he would have had to go inside where support was. So Bobby, that was textbook tackling by Bobby.
So now we got again the kick ready for Okie Kepanek. And again, a boot, and unfortunately for him, went off the side of his foot, and is going to give the Mustangs pretty good field position. It looks like almost about the 23-yard line, so that's not a very good punt, and that sets the Mustangs up. Now we may see from offensive coordinator Fran Best maybe a couple little power plays or something just to get them going, just to get that ball running, maybe get another first down, and then maybe take a shot to the end zone or even try on first down. Again, because it's four-down football, he can take a shot right now.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what they called here.
Well, it looks like we've got four receivers over on the left side. And again, just a straight bubble screen. Attempt to number 23, Torrey Hicks, and unfortunately went straight through his hands. Again, tricky part with the weather like this. If those balls, especially on a screen like that, isn't directly in his chest, it is really hard to bring down. Fortunately, Dan is a smart enough quarterback to make sure that ball was thrown in front of him, so it was not a live ball.
Yeah, Torrey and Dan have played a lot together, and Torrey's very sure-handed. That one was a little over his head. Normally he would catch it, but as we've said numerous times, that ball is probably pretty slick.
So again, setting up just a single back, but we can see that they do have a wing, and they're just going to be moving the ball all around. Probably going to see a little inside bubble screen to number 9, Leslie Green, and he's got such speed and such a gait. But he was able to be to get that first down just on sort of almost an inside screen. We don't see those a lot. But and take him down, a smart play by a couple of the Ducks, who really were made sure that he wasn't getting in right away, and he was going to have to work for everything. So Cale Ganong and a few others were there to really stop him. But it still does put the Mustangs there on, you know, first in about six. And as we've seen, having coached Dan for a while, as we see, if he gets anywhere near the 1 or 2 yard line, it's just going to be a quarterback sneak, because when you have, you know, 300-pound guys in front of you, why bother moving around? So again, that looks like Cam Morley, number 88, for another touchdown. And again, we saw just beautiful blocking by the offensive line. They're all taking their men, and they're creating huge seams for the running backs to be able to run through. Again, it makes it look really easy, but all the hard work is being done up in the trenches, and a former offensive lineman, it must be nice to see stuff like this.
Well, I can tell you that I never played with Cam, but it looks like he'd be fun to block for, because they got a good push, opened up some holes, and then he just found a seam through there and made some people look slower than they are.
So Brady Newcomb is the holder, so we'll see if he'll be able to sort of slide that or hold that down, and the ball will be a little bit lower. It was a little bit high last time, so perfect snap. And George will kick it. Looks like, again, he's trying to kick it up to the people in the end zone bar at the end of the field. So now we have the Mustangs up by 20-0 with about a minute and 53 left. So this for the Ducks is going to be a little daunting now, because now we're talking about, you know, facing one of the premier teams in the league that have obviously, as we've seen, both good, solid offensively and defensively, as well as within special teams. And now you're going to start really seeing the pressure of how do they respond to something like this.
Yeah, it's tough. Your defense is having a really hard time stopping the Mustangs offense, and your offense isn't getting you any field position. It's not the way you want to start a game on the road in the rain.
And this is where oftentimes as coaches, and I've been on both sides of the ball for this, and I think you have too as a player and a coach, this is where you got to make sure that you keep everyone not too up, not too down. You don't want guys getting angry, but at the same time, we've got to keep sort of a level head here. Another booming kick by George, backing them all the way up to the 5 yard line. And we can see he was taken down relatively quickly, but a pretty quick return by number three, Jordan Betteridge. So he was still able to get it up to about, you know, the 25-yard line. So he's averaging about 20 yards per return. So that's not bad. And that at least gives, you know, the Ducks a little bit of breathing room. And, you know, their hope is to try to get on the other side of the center line with a drive. You know, just move those chains a little bit and give the team some confidence, knowing that they can do it.
Yeah, the Ducks need to forget about the scoreboard right now and start thinking first downs here on offense.
So, about to snap the ball, and we'll see what's going on here. So, oh, little pass out to attempt at, yeah, no, he was no catch, but it was pretty close. So that was number 11, Kirkland Burchill, who made a sort of a diving attempt. And again, we can see the problem here is that, you know, with that slick ball, it did not come out of the quarterback's hands very comfortably. And, you know, in a dry game, that's probably in Burchill's hands, and he's probably getting, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 yards off that.
But it was a decent pass, and it was a quick release,
yep,
and showed some poise there.
So it's good, and that's sort of, you got to take the positives away from games like this. So again, we see number 8, Jared Lamming. So flags flying everywhere.
Yeah, we had the right guard. He started a little early on that one.
So we'll have a legal procedure again, and those can be drive killers, and we've seen that before. And this oftentimes will show some inexperience a little bit. They're now feeling the pressure from the front three as well as the linebackers, so they're trying to set themselves up so quickly to make sure that they can protect their quarterback and their running backs. But as we saw there, he was just a little too quick. So it is a tough one. So this again is where the quarterback has to get them in the huddle and just get them, tell them to just sort of take a big deep breath and let's move the ball sort of one play at a time. So again, starting with just a base O, straight handoff. Nice little run by the running backs, and tackle by 22. Again, Dave Cuthbertson. So that would be number 90 who's running. My apologies. That's Nick Lignos. He's more of what we would call like a power running back. That looks like a Jerome Bettis sort of style, but what a difference now. Instead, now they were third and seven instead of, you know, third and 15 or third and 20. And again, their attempt is to really try to move the ball and just get a first down. Again, handoff to quarterback. Nice little move. Unfortunately, the Mustangs are trying to tackle a little too high there. And a power running back like that is really not something you want to try to take on standing up.
Yeah, the Mustangs got caught that time thinking it was an inside run. He blows contain on the defense's left side, and that brings us to the end of the quarter.
So this will be the last play of the first quarter. The Ducks have now gotten a first down, and now they've got a little bit of that confidence. Again, sort of handing it off, but the Mustangs defense this time stopped that. And that was number, looks like number 50, Blake Alain, who was, you know, had blown in and was ready to stop that. So now they're looking for that inside run. So now this is where the Ducks are going to maybe try to start going a little bit more outside, some counter movements, some things like that, to try to slow down this pressure that we're getting from the Mustangs front line.
Yeah, to continue to punch the ball through the middle here and get the Mustangs adjusting, thinking about the interior run, and now would be a good time to start trying to bounce something out or get the ball, fake it and get the ball in the air.
And this is where they may even want to look at sort of a play action, getting the quarterback rolling out. Lamming is a relatively athletic quarterback, and if he can get sort of outside of the pocket and use his legs a little bit, we've seen quarterbacks be able to do that around this league for years. And it's one, again, with only 10 men, it makes it a little bit easier. So again, they're about ready to start the second quarter. Just waiting for the sticks to get set up. Looks like it's second and 15 for the Ducks. And with two backs, so it looks like, again, they're going to go a little bit more to their power run, possibly trying to crack on it. But unfortunately, they're taken down pretty quickly. And we saw a pretty good scraping there by 92, Gab St. Germain, who's originally from Edmonton and has played with the UNB Red Bombers as well as CJEP. And he just simply moved down the line and was able to sort of get some good pursuit against that running back. But we can see now the Ducks are trying to either seal blocks and contain blocks with the receivers, because they know they can't do it all with just their offensive line.
Yeah, not a bad play call, though. They've been running the inside and maybe getting those ends to cheat a bit, and then they break one out, but Gabriel was ready for it.
So now we can see sort of some pressure. We've got a little bit of stand-up, defensive end there. Moving the receivers over now to go trips to one side, and now he's going sort of empty backfield, trying to make that real big shot, and he was, Dave Cuthbertson was ready for it, and those are one of those scary passes as a receiver, knowing that you're going over the middle with that free safety standing there just waiting for you, sort of frothing at the mouth, ready to kind of detach you from the ball and possibly your helmet.
Yeah, but it was a nice clean hit. He got him low and stayed away from the helmet.
And actually, great throw by the quarterback. He put it into a place where only his own receiver was going to get it. So, again, I think the Ducks can take this as a positive. They know they can move the ball now. They know they just have to change up their play calls a little bit. Try to take away some of the strengths of the Mustangs, and right now that has been their interior sort of five or six. Their linemen and their linebackers that are putting huge amounts of pressure on the Ducks.
Yeah, they're definitely having some success with their power running. It's the kind of night that would work well, so I think they can build off that.
So now we have Akeem White back again. Almost had it blocked. White is going to pick it up and has a lot of speed. Is making it down the sideline, but is pushed out at about, looks like the 45-yard line. Nice little return, but again, they've been able to contain sort of these power guys, these speed guys on the punt return. So getting, a 25, 35-yard return is still a good one, but it's not as good as a touchdown. And for the Ducks, they have to look at all the positives that they're getting here.
Absolutely. So now the Mustangs, this is their first series going into the wind. See if it changes the play calling at all.
So it will be interesting, and we can see number three, Brady Newcomb, who is also their quarterback, is also playing receiver as well. So we have a lot of athletes here. Comfort dropping back to throw it, and gets it, and unfortunately was dropped by, it looks like, 23, Torrey Hicks. And again, that's sort of the frustration of trying to get everything set up and the play call's there.
And again, the ball's not always going to be sort of in a perfect spot, but again, Comfort put it in a spot where only his receiver was going to get it, so there's not going to be any interceptions. And Dan is one of the smartest quarterbacks that I've been ever, you know, I've been lucky enough to work with, and he will make sure he does not throw a lot of picks. So now we got the ball again into another running back's hand on the outside. So that's 31. That's Brady Morris again running for a pretty solid, looks like a first down. Again, here's a kid who's got some good size, but he's also got a lot of speed. And he was able to get outside, and they were able to, again, if you can get a first down on a single play, then your offense is running pretty well.
Well, it gives you all kinds of freedom to try things on first down. Brady makes makes one of the defensive backs miss in the open field and then shows some speed extending to the sideline.
And, you know, the good thing is, and here's a kid who just played high school. He's now playing against men, yet he's not showing any sort of fear or anything. He's just running with the ball.
Yeah,
and
he put his shoulder down on that one.
And protecting himself. So we see a little swing pass to Aubrey Ellis. And Ellis, again, is one of those shifty sort of runners. We know that he's going to get the ball, and he's going to fight for every yard. And, again, was able to get about 5 yards on that one. So, again, another nice call there by Best, really kind of keeping the Ducks sort of guessing as to what's going on. So we go from a sweep to one side, straight up the middle, and then all of a sudden we go into, you know, a swing pass to the other side. So it's really hard to defend that because you don't know what's coming next.
Yeah, he's got a number of running backs involved and getting the receiving core involved as well. He's spreading the ball out.
It looks like Ellis was tripped up by his own player on that one. And for the Ducks, that was a good thing because it looked like he had pretty much open field there. Would have had at least a first down and was still almost able to get the first down. It looks like third and about a foot and a half. So, again, you're going to see either just a straight dive or, you know, maybe a quarterback sneak just to get that, you know, that foot and a half. And we know Dan really likes that sometimes. So, but, you know, we see that he's starting out with Caldwell in at fullback and Cam Morley in at straight running back, and he's able to get his yard. Fortunate enough that he's got, you know, that big offensive line to be able to run behind. So you don't have to do a lot. You just have to follow the really big guys.
Sidestepped the blitzer coming in, and then the whole rest of the defense was beyond the first down mark because that O-line had a great push.
And it's interesting watching Morley run that ball. He reminds me, with some of his quickness, very much of Stevie Cormier. Cam might be a little bit taller than Steve, but they run very much the same way, just using their blocks for what they have. So now we got Morley on a sweep outside. Nice cut inside. And there's the difference of someone who's just got speed and guys that know what they're doing. We saw several sort of blocks to break him free. Melanson was the first one that I saw that Morley was able to cut back inside, and Melanson made sure to seal that so there was no sort of tackling from the backside.
Yeah, he did a great job of making the first man miss. And he's done that. He did that on the run before where there's a blitzer. And as an O-lineman, that's great because, you know, it doesn't have to be perfect because your running back's good enough to make that first guy miss, get downfield, and keep blocking, which is what they're doing.
And again, you know, and the rain keeps falling, so, you know, the hope is that you can just keep holding on to that ball. So it looks like an offside. It looks like an offside by the Ducks, but we'll find out in a second. And another flag just went, so that may have been objectionable conduct, possibly. That's usually what happens when they're in the mess of people. Someone probably said something they shouldn't have, which is usually what it is, and the refs will try to do whatever they can to try to keep it. So we have offside by the Ducks, and possibly another one. Oh, he pointed the wrong way. Originally, he pointed to the Ducks, and they are staying at the same spot, so it will be on the Ducks. They'll most likely take it on the kickoff, which is not something you want to give George, because now you're giving him even more spot to get it into the end zone, put that pressure. And again, he's able to sort of... Unfortunately, he missed. It was too wide right. Not wide right Buffalo Bill style, but wide right nonetheless. So, again, this is a tough one where, as the holder, you know, you're trying to make sure that you can hold the ball straight up or however your kicker likes it. And with a slippery ball, it's a little harder to do that. But, again, that's why they do this as much as they can. But we can see these sort of runs. And, again, just setting everything up. And we had guys that were blocking and that's something that coaches talk about nonstop, is about completing your blocks and not stopping until the end, until the whistle goes. And we saw a couple players there hitting one, hitting another, turning around, and continuously sort of getting in a way of someone, knowing that you're setting that up for your returner or for your runner. So Ben George getting ready to kick from the 40, so it looks like it was against the Mustangs, just a 5-yard penalty. So the Ducks hopefully are hoping that they're going to be able to get it on the 10 or 15-yard line as opposed to the 5, which it's amazing how 5 yards can make a difference in 10-man football. So George getting ready to kick off, and again, monster boot, and still right at about the 10-yard line. So Ducks set up a wall, really try to make sure, and boys oh boys, he got stood up pretty quick. So, you know, big hit by 31. Again, we're calling his name a lot, Brady Morris. So nothing better than having a running back who doesn't mind tackling people as well. And Morris did play some linebacker, from what I understood. So here's a kid that, you know, as a coach you like. It's just an athlete, or just a football player.
Yeah, making plays on both sides of the ball. And not afraid to get out there on special teams and downfield.
We always think of that, Terrell Davis. That's sort of how he makes it onto the Denver Broncos years and years ago, by just completely destroying someone on a kickoff. So, again, the Ducks getting ready. One guy was off, so they had too many men. And it looks like the Ducks have now gone to their quarterback being under center. So I think they were just a little worried about holding on to that ball through the shotgun. That's a little tough. And they do have a player down right now, 91. It was kind of hard to see what happened, but Felix LeBlanc, again, it might have been just, just got the wind knocked out of him, or just a little tweak. It doesn't look like he's in too much pain, that sort of thing. But he was stuffed right at the line, the running back, and that can be a real tough one, again, where you can't really move. And there's no real movement. And if you've been practicing primarily with sort of shotgun snap, and all of a sudden you switch to under center, well, that changes all the timing up and everything. So that, if they stay with that, that'll probably take them a little bit to sort of adjust to that. But it may be, at the end, it may be a better way to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that the Mustangs D-line was, they were pinning their ears back on that one because he was under center. That much closer, they've got a better shot at him.
Absolutely, and if you look at it, you have three defensive linemen, and I'm pretty sure the smallest one weighs about 280 pounds. So, again, that's not something that you want. And we look at these guys; they're fast, they're agile, they're strong, and to play as a defensive lineman, you have to have a little bit of a mean streak too. And now you played primarily offensive line, but I know you played some D-line as well. And is it something that, which one did you enjoy more, I guess?
I guess with offensive line, I mean, I love playing on offensive line and being part of the line and the camaraderie there. As I got up further into my career and, realized that someone's health was my responsibility behind me, starting to miss a step here and there, and I felt like maybe playing defense would be a little better.
So, again, we see he's still going under center. Again, the Mustangs are still just completely, they're just pinning their ears back. So that was looked like it was number 96 and number 50. So, again, we have Blake Alain and we have Ben Dunstan. So now they're just daring the Ducks to do anything. And, unfortunately, the problem you're going to have with a play like that is, where do they go from here? If they're now going almost more conservative in terms of their play call, are they just looking at trying to get a little bit of movement? Because I don't think the Mustangs really aren't respecting this offense now, because we're just going straight eye formation with looks like a quarterback and a fumble, and it looks like the Mustangs may have gotten it. Hard to tell.
That's a curious play call with two running backs in the backfield and the quarterback takes off.
Yeah, I'm not sure what was going on, if it was just a missed assignment or if it was, but he stood up as if it was that was planned. So that could be dangerous, especially when you don't have too many quarterbacks. You want to make sure that you protect the ones that you do have. So again, the Ducks will be going to punt. So we'll see the kicker for the Ducks. Kepinek has been doing a pretty good job of sort of getting a high enough ball so that his team can really have a good defense of that.
Not sure what happened there. But, yeah, the Ducks special teams have been doing a good job.
It's yet, no, they've really been able to make sure that the Mustangs have not gotten too much off of this, because we know it doesn't take very much. All it takes is one shot, one little seam, and we've got Akeem White back there again, who we know has a lot of speed. Fumbled snap.
Did a great job.
And we now have a flag of hitting the kicker. So it looks like that will be coming back, and it looks like the Mustangs will actually lose, or the Ducks will get a first down off of that. 22 Cuthbertson grabbed a hold of the kicker and threw him off.
Yeah, so the snap was low, which it's that's common when it's wet.
Yes.
You don't get as good a grip on the ball. You can't throw it as hard back. So it was a low snap. Kicker did a great job of gathering it up and getting the kickoff, but when the rushers coming in saw that ball on the ground, they went straight for it.
That gets you excited a little bit. So looks like it will be first down for the Ducks because of the penalty on roughing the kicker. So now they'll go up, it looks like, another 15, up to the 42-yard line. So the Ducks have a little bit, they have new life here. So let's see what they're going to do now, if they come back just straight under center again, or are they going to go back into a pistol? And it does look like they're going back into straight under center with I formation. Straight handoff, and again, the Mustangs are not worried about it at all. So even a runner who's been running with some power and a little bit of zip in Ryan Fleming is really not having a chance to do much because the defensive line is just blowing the O-line away.
Yeah, you can see that the tailback was tentative on that one. I mean, he probably looked up and saw three Mustang offensive linemen freed up coming towards him.
So again, this is the problem that we do see sometimes in you know, trying to protect your ball players and your quarterback and everyone. But now again, we've got sort of this I formation. They're looking at just going sort of straight off tackle or straight up the middle. Now we have guys moving. Now he has a little bit of thrown and looks like pickoff by number 87, Chris Brown. And Brown was taken off, but he was just playing center field there in the back.
Not sure who made the tackle, but he hustled over and...
That looks actually like their center, if I'm not mistaken, so Curtis. I'm pretty sure that was Curtis Nicholson.
Yeah. So he hustled over and stopped the touchdown.
And very smart play on that one, because that's... you know, they always say when you throw the ball over the middle, three things can happen, and two of them are not good, especially when it's high like that. And that's Brown has been known to do that, and he's played in the Moncton Flag League for years, and he's a guy that just has a knack for getting at the ball. And unfortunately, now this sets up the Mustangs with very good field position, and the Ducks in with not so much good field position. Yeah. So again, we see sort of pressure and movement. Ellis straight up the middle, cutting back and forth, and spinning and bobbing and weaving like a pinball, and they give it to him as a touchdown. Not that there wasn't some good blocking there, but that touchdown was completely on Aubrey Ellis. He just sort of bobbed and weaved his way through the defense and was able to sort of make his way out there. So now we're looking at 32, possibly 33 with the PAT. We're going to be looking soon through Canadian rules at straight time.
Yeah.
Which, you know, in weather like this, if you don't do that, the score could get much worse, and we can also start to see guys getting frustrated. And this is still about, you know, loving the game.
Yeah, yeah. The team on the wrong side of this, pride starts to become a factor and temper starts to flare. But back to that play, Aubrey showed, like, how good he is in a crowd. He just seems to know exactly where he needs to go to make everyone miss.
And flag thrown. Oh, delay of game. So they'll back them up 5 and let them kick again. So I'm not really sure what happened there. It looked like they were missing a player. So, you know, they've got all their personnel now. They'll set themselves up on the line. So now instead of going from the 5-yard line, they'll be going from the 10. It's still only a 17, but really that's still one of those ones that, or they'll take it, I guess it will be on the kickoff, so they'll still take it from the 5-yard line. So again, this is still one of those ones where, you know, we can make a lot of you can make a lot of plays off this, and you know, we see the Ducks, you know, sort of pinning their ears back and hopefully trying to at least stop, take those positives, And it's straight through again for another PAT.
Ben George's kick is good. That brings the score to the Mustangs 33. The Ducks, no score.
So we got 6:30 left in the first half. 33-0 Mustangs over the Ducks. And the Ducks have shown they can play special teams, and they've had some success running the middle. Their passing game hasn't really materialized yet. I think that on that interception, he was open a few steps earlier. That ball needed to come out quicker than it did. A lot of this points to some inexperience on the offensive side.
Yep, and I think that's and their defense for the most part is actually, it's not that their defense is playing poorly. It's just that the Mustangs are executing a little crisper. I think a little bit of it is they're still stinging a little bit from that real tight loss to the Wanderers, which we know it's always going to be. It's a back and forth. That rivalry has been around forever and will continue to be around. So the Mustangs, I think, really set out to make a point today that they are still, one of the premier teams in the league, and they want to continue that.
Yeah, they're definitely not happy about dropping that game, and they don't. They certainly don't want to lose their home opener to another St. John team. So maybe the Ducks are paying a little bit of the price from last weekend's victory by the Wanderers.
And again, this is sort of one of those tricky ones where, there are spots in the field that we can see sort of that, if George wishes to, he could just sort of pick a little spot. But, that could be a little risky, especially with weather like this, but you never know. Having it pinned, and again, he's kicking it to about, looks like the 15. That ball's bouncing a little bit. Returner is looking for a spot, and there's not a lot. So that was number three, Jordan Betteridge, who's had a couple nice returns, but it's really hard when you're trying to pick and weave through, and all you're seeing is shirts from the other team.
Yeah, I mean, if I'm the special teams coach, I'm going to tell them to keep kicking it right down the middle. They're trying to bring it back the middle right into the strength of that coverage.
Absolutely. So the Ducks will be starting off again. We'll see. Their offense is they've got to look after, look for the positives. They have been able to move it some. They know that they've still got lots of work to do. But to go off those basic, those positives, maybe they'll start looking at throwing it sort of to outside as opposed to over the middle. You do have a little bit more. Now they finally come out with their quads as they did before and then just run straight up the middle. Again, smart play. We've got that big power runner again, number 90, Nick Lignos, and that's exactly what it was. So they, all the Mustangs did was brought one more DB over as opposed to two, and I think they were almost waiting for that sort of like trying to counter that and just misdirection play. But now they're now on the 50, and this will be the first time they'll be close to getting sort of over center. So what a positive again for the Ducks. Again, bringing four guys over. And again, are they going to do the same thing? Now, almost fumbled snap. And again, guys still waiting to take, and the Mustangs are still trying to hit a little higher. And we know Lignos is not going to go down that way. He's one of those power runners that will just keep sort of driving those legs. Got another five, almost 6 yards on that play.
Yeah, I like the call. Last time they ran the right to the tight end side, away from quads. This time they kind of fake that and counter to the left and pick up another 5 yards on a nice run. So,
and now what they're doing is they're taking away again the strength that the Mustangs were having, where they were getting so much pressure from their defensive line, and they're kind of going away from that a little bit. So now we'll see that they're setting up now with the trips on one side instead, with the wing over on that side. So you have one guy isolated on the backside, and then the quarterback running sort of a quarterback sneak and being caught. By, it looks like, number 20, by 56 from the Mustangs, which is Andre Heislop. And I do see a flag there. I'm going to say that it was helmet to helmet.
Yeah, it looked like he was a little high.
With 16, which was Cameron Bell. And those, yeah, that can be a hard one sometimes, where you're not trying to hurt someone, but if a guy drops his head a little too much, and sometimes those are just sort of those bang bang plays. But now they have to decide, the referees, with the ruling. I believe they have to decide on whether they can remove him or not. I don't think they will. Not for the first one. They have to prove intent. If I'm not mistaken, the rule was changed a couple years ago. But they will go up 15. So now for the Ducks again, this is sort of new life. It puts them on the other side. And they're now threatening a little bit. They've shown that they can throw it. So yeah, that was a shot. It wasn't helmet to helmet, it was shoulder to helmet, as we can see sort of in the replay. And we did see the quarterback sort of head go down. So that can be a real tough one.
Yeah, and that's two penalties that are breathing life into the Ducks offense here.
So they're starting now with, looks like, first and 10 on the 37-yard line. So now the Mustangs will be ready, trying to really stop some of that. So again, straight sort of run up, and big tackle. He was sort of slowed down by 92, and then he was brought down by 16, Cam Bell. So that would be one of those ones where Cam's really going to try to make up for that that last play. They're going to make sure now only a yard and a half. And one of the things that I noticed, and I don't know if you saw that as well, Bob, was that the running back, when he got the ball, was being really cautious on where he was running as opposed to exploding into the hole. Now, that may be a design play, or it may be the fact that he's looking for who he's going to get hit by.
Yeah, I think he may be reading blocks, too. Like, he may be just trying to find a hole. Like, their O-line is getting a decent push.
So, empty backfield. Quarterback simply going to go for a draw. And we see this quarterback. He does have some legs under him, Lamming. So now we're going third and 4.5. So again, you know, the Mustangs will have to really watch to make sure, you know, do they have a linebacker spy him to make sure that he's not getting outside of the pocket.
So penalties have helped them on this drive, but they're also, they're changing things up with their play calling. They're attacking different areas of the field with different people.
So now we can see he's going under center again, maybe looking at a straight dive up the middle. Really didn't work. Cuthbertson was sort of right in the middle of that, but we also had Ben Dunstan as well as Felix LeBlanc. So these guys were able to actually drop them back a yard. So now it's fourth. And if you're the Ducks, you might as well go for it because this is as good as a punt. Not that you don't want to get that first down, or, you know, do you punt it and go for the point? I think at this time, Your offense has been able to run it and move it. No 3-minute warning, but okay. It looks like the Ducks did take a timeout. So now on a play like this, this is, you know, 4th and 4. What do you do here? You know, it's you can try to run the ball and hopefully get the 3 or 4 yards. Do we go back to sort of Nick Lignos and let him just sort of power his way through and try to get that first down? Or do we, you know, try to throw it? Because the passing game really hasn't really materialized for them yet, but they know that all it takes is one. And the Mustangs, I think, are waiting for this run play.
Yeah, I think if I'm the offensive coordinator, I'm thinking that, I mean, having success with quads, I can roll my quarterback out of that formation and give him a choice. If he can run and pick up the first down, go. If he can't, he's got to throw the ball to somebody. At this point, with 3 minutes left in the first half, and nothing on the scoreboard, it's time to start taking risks.
Yeah, and this is sort of make or break for the Ducks, because they've now been able to, with a couple penalties, move their way down, really threatening to be able to score. If they're able to get this first down, again, what sort of a feather in their cap that they get, and it shows again that they do belong here, and that's what they've got to be telling themselves. They know they're probably not going to beat the Mustangs here, because the Mustangs are very strong, but they know that, you know, they can run with the big boys, so to speak.
Well, a little bit of success at the end of this first half, going into the locker room, will make a huge difference in the tone in that locker room.
And especially with the Ducks returning at the start of the second half as well.
Absolutely.
So again, we're seeing them coming out with straight under center with an I formation. I would be surprised if you see sort of a trick play or something. And Gabe Saint-Germain was in there and was able to stop them, and they were not able to move. And to be honest, I'm kind of surprised with that play call, because they've been able to move it when they've got them, you know, off balance and sort of misdirection and stuff. And they really haven't been successful running sort of straight up the middle with this I formation under center.
Yeah, I mean, as a former offensive lineman, I love that they've got confidence in their offensive line to get a push on that fourth down and get the ball 4 yards downfield. But if I'm thinking as an offensive coordinator, they may have gone to the well a few too many times on that interior run.
But it's you know, it's one that the coaches are learning just as much as everyone else. So again, we'll see the Mustangs. Little sweep out to Brady Morris, but it looks like that'll probably be coming back. We see a flag sort of thrown. Usually if it's in the background, we're probably going to see a hold of some sort. So Morris had a great sort of run there, again picking and weaving his way through. But it is a hold, as we can tell, by the Mustangs, so that'll bring them back 10.
Yeah, no, I was watching number 60, Josh LeBlanc, in the open field, making a fantastic block. Sometimes when you're doing that and the defender turns or pulls away and you don't let go, the flags fly.
And it is hard. It is hard for referees sometimes, because all they might see is just a pull of a little jersey or someone turning a little too much. But, you know, for the Mustangs, they'll look at this and they'll just, okay, just reload and reset and try to do it again. But again, for the Ducks, 2:43 left in the half, if they can stop the Mustangs here and even force them to punt, again, you want to have those sort of positive momentum going into the half. Had some pressure there, it looked like from the left-hand side, going over the left guard, or, you know, either through a stunt or a blitz or whatever it was. But now we've got second and almost 20. He was able to pick his way and get about a yard, so maybe 19.
Yeah, so that's a big win for the Ducks defense there to stop them on that down. Now they're in second and long, and we get to see a little more of this defense.
And again, this is what this defense, they now can kind of bring themselves back and try to cause a little bit more damage. So now we got a sweep out to the left-hand side. Great sort of running just straight upfield by, again, Brady Morris. And he was able to get, you know, another 10 yards. So now it's a little bit more manageable 3rd and 8 as opposed to a 3rd and 12 or 14. So this is one that, with 2:13 left, they'll try to run the clock down a bit. We see Morley coming in, so I wouldn't be surprised if we see the ball end up in his hands at some point.
On that
trying
one,
to really pick and weave.
The linebacker was low, and he's low again, and that it makes it hard to skate across for an outside run.
So now we're going for a pass. And that ball obviously was nowhere near. It's hard to tell who that was going for. It might have been for Morley, but I'm not sure if it got tipped or what it was, but that ball was kind of moving kind of oddly. So so again, we look at this as I believe we see the kicking team coming out. So that was sort of, you know, that's a stop for the Ducks, and they can take that as sort of a positive. So this is the first time we've seen the Ducks return. And the first time we've seen the Mustangs punt. Again, they're on their 37-yard line, so I don't think we're going to see any sort of fakes or shenanigans, especially being up 33-0. It's really about getting, you know, a really good solid punt, and where do we go from there? Now, the one thing that we do notice is I thought there was an onside man, but now the Mustangs did just take a timeout, so I'm not sure if it was a personnel issue or what it is, but there's someone coming back out. It looks like number 53, Corey Lorette, that's coming out. So he's probably just being put on the line.
Yeah, he may have not realized he was on punt team, and this being the first time they punted, we're seeing it.
So now we'll see. You know, we'll see a pretty straight up. We see now, surprisingly enough, we're seeing mostly offensive players on the punt team, which, you know, we don't always see it, but we see a lot of. We've seen Morris and some of these other guys that have a lot of speed and a lot of power. Colby McClenahan as well, who's committed to Dalhousie with the Atlantic Football League, who's a rookie, originally played in Harrison Trimble. We see Brady Morris, and we do. It looks like a possible sort of onside man with Cam Bell. So we'll see if we've got an interesting kick there. And we do have a flag for roughing the kicker. 5 yards by the returners. And we've got nowhere for the returner to go. We're going to see another flag down there, most likely a hold. But we'll get it first for the roughing the kicker, which looks like it'll be a first down for the Mustangs again. And if we saw that... unfortunately, the guy trying to block the kick just skimmed the foot a little bit too much and spun Ben George around. And he doesn't look too happy about it, but no one usually is when they get caught with that. But, you know, kickers also know how to play the game as well, and if they get hit, they're taught to move. So we'll see how this finishes. So the referee will be making a decision. Right now he's asking head coach Jason Terrace what he wants, as well as Dan Comfort. So they'll give them options on what they can do if they want to re-kick. My guess, normally it's a 10-yard penalty, if I'm not mistaken, or a 15-yard. So that should be a first down. But they're having this discussion right now, trying to figure out what it's going to be, because we did have another penalty down there as well, which I haven't even seen. My guess would be sort of a hold. So again, this is sort of where it gets sort of interesting, and you never want to be the ref with that, trying to figure out, okay, what do we take? So it looks like, well, the offense is going off, so it looks like the Ducks will get the ball and be going back.
So I'm guessing here that the penalties would not have resulted in a first down. So they declined and first down for the Ducks.
Yeah, exactly. So they might have been called it incidental contact or whatever it was. So again, that'll still drop the Ducks back. They're still on their 25-yard line, so that's still not a long way to go. That's still a long way to go with a minute 40 left. And again, this is where, do we take a couple shots here and try to force the Mustangs back? Because the problem they've been doing is when they don't do that, the Mustangs are just pinning their ears back and hitting these guys behind the line.
Yeah, well, they've got to do something to get that defense on its heels a little bit right now. They're definitely not looking like they're thinking prevent right now.
We're looking, we can see sort of Cuthbertson playing safety, getting ready for the ball. Now, it looks like they're still moving the ball around. So I'm not sure. I didn't see what the penalty was, so I'm not sure why it's being set up there, especially if it was holding the back. But
that second flag must have been
something else going on. So it must have been a Mustang as well, or it was just applied. So anyway, it goes. We're at about the 39-yard line of the Ducks. Again, now we have quarterback in shotgun with a single back. We're probably going to see a few attempts at passes. And that's exactly what we were talking about, was trying to make those throws to the outside as opposed to sort of throwing it over the middle. quarterback number 8 again, Jared Lamming, received a little pop after release on the ball, and it's welcome to the MFL.
There's a little misdirection on that. I think it might have been a guard pulling or could have been the fullback,
and,
but
and trying to confuse yep. and that can work as long as he's not going downfield. So we'll see again, probably another attempt at a pass or straight up the middle, and again going for his favorite person to hand off to, Nick Lignos, who just runs. Again, you know, it's what you like to see in a running back of his size, is a guy that just likes to run angry and is protecting himself and is running low and is making himself really difficult to take down. But again, now the Ducks are moving the ball. We're talking 3rd and 4, and the Mustangs have to try to figure out, okay, how do we stop sort of this internal run? They know they can do it when they're under center, but this is a little tougher. They're using that wing.
They got 3 D linemen down and 1 stand. Oh, 2 stand up ends. So there's 2 down linemen.
So on a single end. So now straight pass. Oh, and a pick by, looks like number 6, Bobby McIntyre, trying to. Oh, jeepers. And
no whistle yet.
No whistle yet, and they're still going. Now that was number 7. Jerome Chimpangila, who picked it up at the end. Bobby got hit sort of again. We're talking wet game. We also have a player down, injured.
It's possible Bobby may have played some rugby in the days.
that was an interesting run back. We do have a flag on the play as well. It could be for a blindside block or a remote hit. I'm not really sure. So we'll have to wait and see what the ref calls. But I see the ball coming back, so I'm going to guess most likely that it was on the Mustangs, from what I can tell. But we'll get the call from the ref, and we'll see now.
Anytime there's a turnover,
so a block in the back,
play.
Yeah. And that's exactly what happens. You know, you'll get those defensive players aren't used to blocking, so it is a block in the back, so it'll still go back. So instead of being where you know, down on the 2 or 3 yard line, the Mustangs instead will be on center. We still do have player down, number 89. And I haven't seen anything on what happened there, but Travis Blaw, but it, again, it might be one of those ones where he got hit from the side or whatever, and there was a big mess of people there, so sometimes we'll see incidental hits there. So again, the Ducks are coming out, 47 or 46 seconds left in the game, or sorry, in the half. So again, if you're the Mustangs here, you probably just run it a few times and try to, you know, get a couple couple first downs and really just move it. And again, you know, the Ducks, really what you want to do here is just stop this. You want to try to stop any sort of drive that they have. Comfort about to call the play in the huddle, and we'll see kind of where they go from there. So O-line is running to the line, ready to go. Single back. So Comfort's throwing it. We've got three guys that are wide open. Comfort running the ball, sliding smartly. Something that Dan doesn't always do is, because he is a strong fella and he will take a shot now and then, but he's also a very smart quarterback, and he knew that he got the first down, so he slid. Now we do have a flag down, but it looks like it's going to be on the Ducks this time, because they are speaking to Corey Lorette, the captain. So my guess would be, you know, possibly pass interference, usually something like that, because he's giving them the option of where he wants to take the ball, and he's saying, push them back. So as we get the call from the referee, we'll see. Oh, too many men. So it's going 10. Interesting. So we'll see how that goes. Two hands on the head is always objectionable. So the Mustangs will be now on the 43-yard line. Again, we have 39 seconds. And then the question becomes, you know, do we take another shot down the field, see if we can score a bit more? Do we just work with our power running game? We know we have lots of running backs. We've got, looks like Ellis in there right now. We know Ellis can sort of pick his way through a field. Dan's going to throw it up, wide open, and receiver did not sort of really adjust. Those 23, Torrey Hicks, so a little bit of miscommunication there. Dan trying to throw on his outside shoulder, and Torrey running sort of more to the inside. But again, these are sort of small things that you want to work on. And it's hard sometimes when that ball's wet. It's really, you can't put it exactly where you want to.
Absolutely.
And Dan is one of those quarterbacks that he's very critical of himself. So he'll be always sort of adjusting and trying to figure out what to do. But again, for the Ducks, this is sort of a positive. If you can hold them at the end, go into halftime not having been scored on again, then you can go from there. So again, we have this little swing pass to Ellis, and Ellis in open field is as dangerous as you can get, but we're going to have another hold there, it looks like. So we may see again Ellis, you know, all that work, and it may be coming back.
So Dan Comfort showing on the last two plays, the play before, great patience. He looks around, he doesn't see anything he likes, moves around the pocket a little bit and takes off. That play, he makes a beautiful arching pass over a defender, perfect, puts it perfectly in Ellis's hands, and Ellis takes off and does some damage, but we get a penalty.
And here, again, so we're seeing it looks like most likely a holding penalty. Yep, so it'd be holding on the Mustangs, so that'll take them back another 10. So again, you know, that could be frustrating, but this again is sort of learning for the Mustangs as well. You know, they're looking not only for today's game, but they're also looking for, you know, being one of those top four teams playing in the semifinals on June the 15th, and hopefully, you know, going to their fourth straight Maritime Bowl. So they're going to take each of these mistakes that they've made and really try to fix those to make sure that they're ready later on in the season.
Absolutely.
Okay, Comfort ready to throw again. Big throw and out of bounds. Trying to get it. Looked like to Cam Morley. But again, kind of tough one. You know, the hands get cold. The ball gets pretty slick, and it's kind of hard to really hit anyone. But again, Comfort put it there, and that was Matt McDonald, who was the intended receiver. But again, this was the attempt of, you know, if McDonald wasn't getting the ball, no one was. So we see they take Ellis out and bring Brandon Caldwell in. So now Caldwell playing a wing back and having Cam Morley in. So straight sweep to the outside. Again, beautiful blocks by the Mustangs, and Morley just showing his speed. And and one of the best downfield movements I've seen. If we saw Torrey Hicks running straight with him, and he was like a blast out of the past, just constantly going, and he was going to make sure that no one was getting Morley on that. But again, we see that's the difference sometimes when you have an athlete who's got that much speed and can really kind of pick his way through. It's the reason why he's been returning kicks. I believe he's returning kicks in Acadia as well and playing some receiver. But he just has that extra gear that once he's in the open field, no one's really going to stop him. But again, this is a little demoralizing to the Ducks because they were 5 seconds away from stopping the Mustangs, and they had actually made some good plays. So again, we see movement. Most likely, it looks like on the Ducks. So again, we'll look at 5 seconds. If it is on the Ducks, then the Mustangs will just decline it and kick the ball.
Yeah, offensively right now, I mean, Dame Comfort doesn't have to force anything. He didn't like what he saw. He got pressured a little bit on that pass on the sideline. He just put it where he knew his guy's the only guy that's going to get it. They go back to a nice run play with explosive guy like Morris, and he makes a big play, and all of a sudden they're in the end zone.
And Fran Best he's also calling it an excellent game. He's basically taken what they're going to give him. We saw that little movement out. And Newcomb was able to, after having a little bit of a bobbled snap, and was able to make it and get 2 points for the Mustangs. Again, that's why it's nice sometimes to have your holder as an athlete and sort of backup quarterback, so he can kind of get that ball out of there.
Second botched PAT snap / hold. I'm not planning to blame on either guy, but he was ready to throw a pass on the last one. And on this one, there was no hesitation. As soon as he knew he had to go, he went.
And that may be something that the coaches had talked to him about too, said, look, you've got the legs, get out and don't even worry about looking at throwing it, just get the ball out there. So now we have 5 seconds left in the half. The Mustangs will look at, probably sort of squibbing it, trying to just kill the rest of the clock. The Ducks are hoping to be able to get sort of a good return. Looking at the first half, the Ducks special teams for the most part has been really good. They've been solid. They haven't really let any big sort of plays happen. And George has got sort of that leg that he's able to really hammer it down. So for them to be able to get some good solid returns, 20, 25 yards, to be able to have a couple botched snaps, whether it's pressure, whether whatever it is, we see this coming now with George. So now we're going to see sort of straight up kick, return, bobbled the ball, and now he's looking for sort of an open space. And taken down pretty quickly there by, looks like, 16 Campbell, and that'll end the half. So with the end of the first half, we have 41-0 for Moncton, and we can see sort of at the half, Moncton has been playing well, but they haven't been mistake free. And as we've already talked about, they're trying to fix those mistakes, because you may have to play in like poor weather like this. So you want to make sure that you can get as much as you can out of it, learn it, and do whatever you can. Okay, and we'll be back with the second half shortly. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, welcome back. We're just getting ready to start the third quarter here. Mustangs and the Ducks. It hasn't gone completely for the Ducks. They've been able to have some positives, move the ball a little bit. Their special teams have played really well. But now we'll see. With straight time, the Mustangs, now this plays in their favor. If they can get longer drives, they'll really be able to move the ball and take a lot of time off the clock.
Yeah, I think they want to try and get the ball. Yeah, the Mustangs, I think, are going to want to get the ball into other people's hands, get some other people in the game, work on their systems, and try and keep the Ducks off the board.
Yeah, I may not. I may be surprised, but you know, we may even see Dan Comfort come out and Brady Newcomb go in and get a little bit of experience. Again, playing against, you know, if you're used to playing high school, now you're playing against grown men, and you're playing against some guys that can hit pretty hard. So now we'll see you know, kind of how the game's going on and how the players are going to respond. And this is one that, you know, you're down by 41 with a half to play. What do the Ducks do now?
Well, I think they've got to try and build on the few things that did work. I mean, their special teams continue to do a good job there. They've got to try and find an identity on offense. They were able to run the middle a little bit in the first half. That kind of, the Mustangs just adjusted and stopped them from doing that. That doesn't mean they need to stop power running, though. I think that they can still find some success on the edge.
And it could very well be just a way to kind of move things back and forth and try to get, you know, some quick passes out, maybe a little bit of misdirection. They were doing some pretty interesting stuff when they were bringing sort of quads over to one side and then running either to the tight end or you know, wing side or going backside. And really trying to kind of put the Mustangs back on their heels, because as a defense, if you're back on your heels, you're thinking, you're not able to react as quickly, and then, you know, you've got some pretty good runners. You know, we've seen all these different runners going along, but I think of, like, Nick Lignos, who's just running with such energy and such power. To get the ball into his hands is one of the best things you can do.
Yeah, if they can start the second half with, they're going to be receiving.
Yep, so the Ducks will be receiving, and the Mustangs will be kicking off. So, we'll see, you know, the Mustangs will have the wind with them for the third quarter, and the Ducks will have it in the fourth quarter. You know, maybe we'll see a bit more passing. It wasn't always working for the Ducks, but, you know, maybe they'll be able to sort of move some more stuff up.
Yeah, and for the players that are new to the MFL that are on the Ducks, you know, the veterans have got to tell them that, okay, you've got three halves of football in the books. You should be starting to adjust to the speed and understanding what you need to do to be competitive at this level.
And that is a real difficult one, especially when you have runners that the Mustangs have been throwing at them, like Brady Morris, like Aubrey Ellis. We have guys that are running with strength, really good cutbacks, and some speed. You know, when you see speed like a Cam Morley, how do we make sure it's not just, you're not just playing sort of high school or pickup where you can just, you're the fastest guy. Now it's all about angles. It's all about sort of trusting the system.
And team defense. You can't expect that your linebacker is going to be able to make a play. You know, if you're a corner, you need to start running. You need to get in there, assume that you'll be the one that makes the play.
And not that I'm a Patriots fan, but, you know, the Bill Belichick motto of do your job really does apply here. And if every player can do their job, then you can limit how much success an offense or a defense has.
That may or may not be true, but I'm not going to acknowledge it.
Oh, I'm not a Raiders, or I'm not a Pats fan either, so that's okay. I'm sure we'll hear from the viewers on that one. So, George, about ready to kick off. And the third quarter is underway. Big boot into the end zone, and now you're going to see a lot of pressure coming on the returner. Sometimes this can be a good thing, sometimes it can be a bad thing, but it was an okay return by, it looks like, again, number four, Thomas Laforme or Jordan Betteridge. So these are guys that have some speed, and now the Ducks are set up in really tough position, first and 10 on their own 10-yard line, and that's where, you know, having a leg like George has to really kind of pin those guys back, and now the Mustangs really have the chance to to end it right here and really put pressure on them, either try to hit the quarterback, try to, you know, throw off their timing. And this is also time for the Ducks to be able to maybe
throw a little one because the Mustangs will be waiting for this power run. So a little play action, something like that. Next thing you know, the Ducks are able to get the ball into some of their athletes' hands.
Well offside.
Offside, number four. So he was waiting for something. I think he was hoping that no one was going to see him, but that was Thomas Laforme. So again, the Ducks will go back, and it'll go halfway back. So now they're on their five-yard line. So it should be interesting to see what Jason Terrace, head coach and defensive coordinator, sort of dials up for his defense here. I wouldn't be surprised if we saw some form of stunt blitz package coming up and really trying to throw off the timing of the quarterback, again, who's on his own goal line receiving the snap. So straight run up, beautiful run, beautiful tackle there. So that was, again, by number 22, Dave Cuthbertson, a very vocal and visual sort of player. He's going to, not only is he going to hit you, but he's going to tell you how he hit you, and he's going to make sure that you know that he's coming again.
It looked like on that one there was an interior blitz by the left interior linebacker. The running back either adjusted or it was an outside play, but Cuthbertson came up quick.
So, again, that's a tough one there, brought down, it looked, by number 96, Ben Dunstan. And oh, sorry, my apologies. That was 56, Andre Heislop. So he was able to really step into that hole and stop the running back. Again, when you have a running back like Lignos, that's a real tough one. So now the Ducks have third and four and a half. So their hope is to be able to get a first down to try to give themselves a little bit more breathing room. So again, we see sort of lots of guys in the back. One single running back, lots of movement around, running off tackle, and boys oh boys, Lignos can run, and he runs angry. It looks like he's got a first down, so he got about, you know, 7-8 yards on there, and they just, again, ran off tackle, and they tend to be running away from their strength. So now the Mustangs are going to have to try to figure out how to stop this.
Yeah, I think that the Mustangs, they're not showing a lot of mercy here, and they're still blitzing, and on that one they got caught upfield, they stretched it a bit. And some nice blocking on the edge.
And the old saying is, you know, you live by the blitz and you die by the blitz. So we'll see the pressure coming on, and they're just sort of riding that horse, booming out of the backfield. Lignos, and he was brought down by 27, Joel Rickard. So again, we're seeing they're just sort of blitzing, or they're just sort of blasting straight up the middle. You know, if I'm the offensive coordinator for the Ducks, it's until they stop it, let's just keep going with it. So now the Mustangs defense is going to have to try to figure out again how to stop this.
Mustangs sending heat again.
And Lignos is sort of picking it up, and he's going to punish guys every time they try to hit him.
Yep, great run. Mustangs blitzed on the defensive right, and the run went up the interior on the defensive left, so just a lot of pressure on the linebacker on that side to do it all.
So again, we saw another first down. And basically, we're seeing the same play over and over and over again. They're just running straight up the middle, sometimes using their wing almost like a lead blocker, other times just sort of trying to almost pinch the defensive line in there. So again, we'll see. They've got their three-man line with two linebackers, and the Ducks are looking pretty strong right now. Flag going, so it looks like it's most likely going to be an offside or a legal procedure by the Ducks. It looked like their left guard moved a little too quickly, and the Mustangs sort of responded to that. So we're waiting for the call by the referee. So he's calling offside on the Mustangs. Okay, so now they'll give them the option of what they want to do. They're going to go up five. So now it's first and five. Again, now on the Mustangs side of the field. And we saw this happen in the first half where penalties can give them that new life. Now they have sort of three shots at getting a first down with only 5 yards needed. So, again, we're seeing that pressure. Again, handing straight off to Lignos, and that time that was not happening. Stopped by 50, Blake Elaine, and 56, Andre Heislip. And we're able to sort of stop him, and I don't even think he got back to the line of scrimmage, or just got back to the line of scrimmage. So again, the Mustangs will be looking at trying to stop this power running game. Lignos is being brought off for a second, probably to give him a little bit of a breath, because he's been their chariot the whole time of this first half, or the second half drive.
Coach Terrace responds to that the yards up the middle with a run blitz and shuts it down.
Now we got a fumble, but he was able to recover it. And again, that's you know, you take that your running back that's getting it all, and you have a guy that hasn't played a lot, and he's seeing again some pretty powerful guys, and that can throw you off a little bit, and he's just gonna remember his coach will tell him, you know, just trust your training and trust your skill and run the ball the way you know how to. So we'll really look at, and that was Ryan Fleming, I believe, for the Ducks. So we'll see again the Ducks set up with a basic sort of split, you know, two receivers on each side, single back in with the wing back. Now looks like sort of open, almost another pick, straight slant attempted to Thomas Laforme. And again, the tricky part with those types of slants, especially out of the shotgun, normally that's a single step drop and out a little quicker. Now waiting for that ball to come back, he's now a little bit more inside, and you've got safety sort of waiting there for you. So it's a little bit of a different play, but if he hits his receiver in the hands, you've probably got another 5 or 6 or 7 yards.
Yeah, and that was it was a little slow, but it wasn't bad. It was probably the quickest I've seen him deliver the ball, and that's definitely something that he can build on.
And he is looking a little bit more confident now. We're not seeing sort of the skittish feet as much as he is, trying to run really quickly. So it looks like Mustangs just took a timeout. So most likely this is Coach Terrace wanting to talk to, well, it looks like he's coach talking to number six, Bobby McIntyre, probably just getting him to calm the defense down and get them to remember to do their job and really make sure that they're just stopping this interior run, because all it takes is Lignos getting his hands on the ball again. All they have to do is constantly stop him and make sure he's not going through. And as we can see right now, we have a four-man line for the Mustangs. So now they're almost daring the Ducks to run up the middle, because now you have, you know, Caldwell, you have Gab St-Germain, you have Ben Dunstan, as well as Blake Elaine. So now you have four really strong, fast players, and now you're almost daring them to try to run sort of between the tackles, or between the guards at least, within the 10-man system.
Yeah, the veteran Brandon Caldwell checking in to play some defensive end on the strong side.
And Caldwell is one of those players that he's actually quite smart when it comes to football knowledge. He really knows what he does, and he knows how to use his size well. So he'll make sure to disrupt as much as he can. So as we saw the guard pointing out to the H-back, and Caldwell almost a completion there, but Caldwell unfortunately was in the face of the quarterback, Jared Lamming, and that's a real tough one. So that was their attempt on fourth down. Again, this has been sort of that constant thing where it's almost been sort of a Jekyll and Hyde offense, where they'll be able to move the ball really well, and then they're not able to move the ball. So the coaches will be working, obviously, much more on consistency. And again, for a first-year team, this is pretty good, going up against sort of one of the perennial powerhouses of the Maritime Football League.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of those welcome to the MFL moments when you've got Brandon Caldwell bearing down on you, and you hold it in the pocket and deliver a decent pass.
And we now see Newcomb in at quarterback, so they have pulled Dan Comfort, as any sort of smart offensive coordinator is going to do. And that was a great power run thereby, looked like Brady Morris. So again, this is, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if we see a lot of this just sort of turning around and handing it off, really trying to wear down that clock, and taking your shots when you can, just to keep the defense honest.
Yeah, they're going to cycle in some newer players and try and get everyone some game time here, but that doesn't mean they're not going to try and drive the ball down the field.
See, again, straight handoff up to Morris, and beautiful block. Great outside run. Looks like there should have been, I'm surprised there was not a flag thrown on. Oh, there was a flag thrown on that, because it did look like a horse collar there. Again, you know, with the game that we always play in Canada, one of the things they always look at is, where does that tackle start? If it started at the top, most likely you're going to see it, but it looks like they're just saying that the flag fell out. So, oh, yep, it is horse collar. Okay, so they will be going up another 15 yards, so that can be, again, that can be pretty demoralizing to the defense. But Morris just ran a really nice run there, and the blocks really set up well, and he read off his blocks well, which is always a hard one sometimes when you're used to sort of being sort of the man and just running in open field. Now he's learning how to pick and pick his way through the defense.
Yeah, he's making explosive cuts, and the defense, that penalty is a result of them being unsure of their ability to tackle it.
Now we're letting Newcomb sort of throw it. He's got some speed, and he does have some legs, and unfortunately he wasn't able to make it.
And Brandon Caldwell running a looked like an out route.
It was a drag, actually. He did run a drag. So, and you know, with that type of offense where you do have that wing, if you're moving your quarterback sort of in, if you're getting him sort of rolling out, you're usually going to use your wing as sort of that last sort of dish effort. If you got nothing else, you'll just dump it off to him. Unfortunately, Newcomb was not able to sort of complete that. But again, it's good for him to be able to sort of go with this and realize exactly what it takes to play quarterback in the MFL. So again, handing it off to Newcomb, or off to Morris, and Morris just running with such speed and such purpose, reading his blocks really well.
Man, the D-end Caldwell on that one is a slot back and playing a role that Dwayne Ells made famous. Defensive end coming over and making big blocks and potentially catching a pass, as we saw. He can run a route, and he's a multi-sport athlete. He has hands,
and he is a basketball player by trade, and he definitely can catch the ball when he needs to. So now we'll see again the Mustangs really threatening to score here. With it being third and two, you're probably going to just see a straight run, get the ball into his hand, in Morris's hands, and he runs again with such strength, and he's able to kind of pick his way through. But again, the blocks were set up so well for him that it was not a difficult run for him. He just had to kind of find his way through. Again, you know, we have a rookie lineman out there with two veterans, with Jarek and Corey Lorette. We do have a rookie in Josh LeBlanc. But we have Jarek McWilliams and Corey Lorette, who have done a lot, and we actually have three Moncton High guys all playing on the line, so they know how to play the game. They've been coached very well by Coach John Olenek, and they know exactly what to do. So again, we'll see what's going to go on here with the snap. We know Moncton has struggled with it a little bit, but beautiful snap there and beautiful kick. And not only was it in there, but again, it was halfway through the parking lot, as Ben George likes to do. So now we've got the score of 48-0. Again, we 3.5 minutes, 3:45 left. So we'll see. You know, Moncton might get the ball once or twice more, depending on how the Ducks were able to move the ball. So again, what did the Ducks coaches do? Did they just tell them, you know, just keep plugging away? Let's find the positives out of this.
Yeah, 48-0. You're running straight time, so we've got about another 20 minutes here of football. Straight time. You know, you gotta, as a coach, do your best to keep your guys in the game. Build on any successes that you have. There was a little penetration by the D line that time. Morris wasn't having any of it. He just ran right through the hole he was supposed to. But I would say that I would try and focus on any positives I could find. Special teams has definitely been one of them.
So again, we see number four. Thomas LaForme getting the ball and really trying to make it, getting a good seam, getting stood up by a couple Mustangs and continuing to go. But my apologies, that was number 21 returning the ball. So that was Jonathan Marino. And again, you know, not too bad of a return. You know, he got it again at about the 15-yard line, is able to get it out to about the 35. So again, they're having these sort of these positives. So now they know, and we talk about it, especially in the Canadian game, special teams is so important. So this is something for you to sort of build off of. And now we see a straight run. And although he's trying to read the blocks, that can be pretty scary when you have the likes of Gab St. Germain and Ben Dunson coming down on you. So for Ryan Fleming to sort of run, he is looking for blocks, but you know, this might be one where you just want him to sort of run downfield and try to get 2 or 3 yards rather than trying to wait to see who's going to open up where. So that might be sort of one of those interesting ones. So again, we're looking now at almost five guys on the line now. So they have four plus a wing. And again, they're just going to hand off. And he's just waiting almost a little too long. So he, again, taken down again by Dunstan and Jerome Chimpanigla. Chimpanigla. There we go. That's a tough one. You're not going to try that, so what's film, Jerome? But great sort of penetration there, again, by our by the
Mustangs
D-line and their linebackers, so that's where Jerome is playing. We also have number 24, Alex Robichaud, playing, a rookie, playing with the UNB Red Bombers. So, again, they're really reading well here. And now we're back again to, you know, the power runner of number 90, Nick Lignos, and he's going to just keep going, and he's going to keep hammering down.
So Lignos' running style is very different than the prior running back. Sorry, I forgot his name. Not tentative at all. He's going where he's going, and if if you're an old lineman and you're where he's going, you're going to move after the...
And we know running backs like that. And so now we've got fourth and about a yard and a half. And if you're the Ducks, you have to go for it. You know, you need to get that first down. Give it to Lignos. Just let him hammer down and get... Well, as we see, he got almost 6 yards. So this is, again, this type of runner that, you know, unfortunately for him, he's... You know, he's only got so much gas in the tank, but I think he looks like one of those runners that the more he gets the ball, the faster he gets. And if you're a defensive player, you don't want that that speed and that size coming at you. And again, we're seeing sort of this hammer one. So now the defensive line, we see the difference is they're not going around. The ends are not sort of containing. They're just standing, creating a wall, and making him run into it.
Yeah, and there's the end of the third quarter. Yeah, as an O lineman with a running back like Lignos, you know you've got to make your block and make it quick, because if you don't, he's going to hit you, not the not the defense.
And that's something that, you know, we do teach linemen a lot, is that if you don't make the block, their cleats are going to be on the back of your legs. So the last play of the third quarter will go. We'll most likely see Lignos get the ball again, but instead quarterback takes it on a quarterback keep and is taken down. By a host of Mustangs. Sorry, that's my job as a high school teacher. I'm used to calling these guys. But number eight, again, what an athlete, Jared Lamming. You know, he should be fun to watch over the next few years, because he's relatively young. He's got some really good athletic skill, and I think he brings a lot to the Ducks.
Yeah. No, he's shown good athleticism, good speed, and. I mean, it's hard to judge a quarterback's arm on a night like tonight, but he has made some decent throws.
So now we see the Mustangs, and the Ducks will be changing ends. So now we're looking at the Ducks with, I believe it's, I can't see, third down at about eight. So again, you know, the Ducks have to decide what type of game they want to finish up with. This is where, you know, you sort of throw the gauntlet down to your team, and it's like, look, let's go for like one good solid drive, try to score, whether it's a field goal, whether it's a single point off a rouge, or whether if it's a touchdown. But you know, you have that big running back in the backfield, so use him. Now we can see they have sort of twins, so sweep to the outside, and far too much pressure, and far too much hesitation again by the running back, and that can be, again, We could attribute that to inexperience, I think, and just not knowing sort of that you don't have time to wait around. And that looked like Matthew Quinlan, who's listed primarily as a fullback. So fullbacks are usually not used to running sweeps.
Yeah, and I mean, it's easy for us to point out that was a slow developing play, but personnel-wise, we're not really sure. And when did they put that play in? How much have they grooved it? But that definitely needs to pick up the pace on that one. That toss was late.
And it's now their O-line is doing quite well. They've been able to sort of like protect the inside. We haven't seen, other than the few sacks in the first half, we really haven't seen a lot of pressure on the quarterback other than your traditional one. But they also haven't attempted a lot of passes. But we've seen some really good protection there. So again, the kicker is getting ready. And short little kick being picked up. And no yards. On the Ducks, it looks like. And it looks like another penalty on I'm going to guess number 62 of the Ducks, who looks like it looked like a remote hit there as well. So we'll see whether it is actually was no yards or if the Mustang player touched it first. So we're going to see a couple plays. And the ref is deciding now exactly what he's going to do.
Yeah, I believe it was touched. So I think the no yards may come back.
Yep, so now that's what they're discussing right now on whether it was touched or not. And it's a tough one because sometimes it's one of those sort of bang-bang plays. Was the guy within the 5 yards when it was touched at first? Because then it makes it sort of, it doesn't matter because he was still within the 5 yards. As we can see, sort of Bobby, who's known for being very vocal, and he was showing exactly how it happened. He was letting all the refs know, too.
Yeah, Bobby knows the rules. He'll make sure that he knows the rules.
So it looks like the refs are calling it, and I'm going to say that they're saying it was not touched, or it was touched, and that the Ducks actually recovered it. So it looks like the Ducks will be getting the ball back, and Moncton's defense will be coming out again to try to stop the Ducks and put some more pressure on them. But we're also seeing the ball go back. So I'm going to guess that there was the remote hit as well. It looked like on 50 Blake Elaine. So this is where sometimes those penalties can still hurt you because instead of them getting it now on the Moncton side of the field, they're back in on their own field as well.
Yeah, and Blake's a veteran, and he's a very intense player. I guess the Tiger got out of the cage on that one, but there's no excuse for that type of play. It's the MFL is not the place for that. So
absolutely, and you know, so when Blake got hit, it was sort of an interesting one. He can be a tough one to deal with sometimes, but he brings a level of intensity that you need on a defensive line.
Yeah.
So we can see now we have four guys on the line, two stand-up ends and two tackles, going against sort of the five guys that the Ducks have on their line. Trying to sort of like balance those off. And again, they're going to give it to Lignos, who's now just running outside off tackle, and looks like he might actually have a touchdown. Or is he going to get caught?
Nope.
It does not look like it. So the Ducks have now scored. So there's no zero, and we've just been waiting for it. I'm sure Lignos' stats are going to look pretty good after the end of the game. I would venture to say he was probably 150 or 200 yards today, and a lot of hard-fought yards, too. These are not just single, you know, easy runs that he's having. So there's sort of your heart and hustle player of the game because there's a guy that has not given up. And to be able to run sort of that 60 yards to score the touchdown. But again, this is, we can see where sometimes penalties can hurt us. And sort of some of those errors. So again, this will be something that the Mustangs will clean up, looking to try to always sort of improve. And now you've got a positive for the Ducks. They weren't blanked.
Absolutely.
And that's a huge one.
And the Ducks had four offensive linemen, well, three, a tight end and a slot, all big guys. So they were going big on big. The Mustangs adjusted to that. They saw it last series. They had a lot of people up on the line, and when Lignos hit that secondary, it was just a foot race, and he won it.
And surprisingly had more speed than I expected. So he, like we've seen a lot of the power running, but we haven't seen the 60-yard run. So he's a guy that, again, is going to bring a lot of fun to the Maritime Football League, hopefully over the next many years. He's another guy that, you know, again, we always think back to sort of John Haynes and St. John, who had the size, had the speed, had the mean, had all of those things, and you see glimpses of that in Lignos, who again is running sort of very powerfully.
Well, yeah, that's the traditional knock against the power runner is, you know, he doesn't have that fifth gear. He's not going to extend a play and score a touchdown. And on that one, he beat the whole defense. So great job by him on that play, and that's definitely something that the Ducks can smile about.
So now the Ducks are setting up to kick off the PAT. Nice snap all the way through, and they got their single point. So now it is 48-7 for the Mustangs. Again, the Mustangs will be receiving the ball. They have some pretty dangerous returners. We've seen Akeem White. We've seen Cam Morley. And there may be others we just haven't seen yet. But, you know, never count out. All it takes is just sort of one seam, and those guys are gone. But we've seen a difference and a huge change in the sideline with the Ducks. We see guys smiling now and a couple of high fives, and it's not as intense, and guys are realizing that, you know, football can be fun.
Yeah, I mean, as an offense, when you get that touchdown, even if it's late in the game where the outcome is already decided, you get to the sideline, there's some smiles and some high fives and a sort of a sense of relief.
So again, we see, so it is Akeem White who's back for the Mustangs. And maybe this is something where, and it looks like the Mustangs are sort of preparing for it just in case, maybe this is a chance where you try to do an onside kick, because really it's not going to hurt you much. You're still at midfield. Your defense is playing a little bit better, and you're able to stop them. So we'll see what happens here. Okay, just straight up the middle, right into Hicks's hands. Akeem White's hands. He's got amazing movement. Unfortunately, was not able to stay up, but he almost broke that. And again, he's sort of a little bit like Gumby there, was bending in ways that I don't think the human body is meant to bend, but still a good return after a little bit of a bobble. So the Mustangs will start on their own, looks like 46-yard line or 47-yard line. So again, we have Brady Newcomb in under center, and we'll most likely see Brady Morris running. It looks like Brady Morris running. So again, we're seeing sort of lots of receivers, lots of new guys out. So now this is the time to really get some of that work in to make sure that all of those little things are working well. And again, Morris is just running with such purpose and such speed. So he was right there and was able to get a really good run. So Justin Ellingwood, who's also playing fullback, is, it looks like he's playing in at linebacker as well, and was able to make a good tackle to stop Morris from getting any more yards. He was still able to get five, but again, we're always looking for the positives, and it was a good football play. So again, we can see the Ducks threatening blitz, and then backing up a little bit, really separating. Unfortunately, Morris tried to make a cut, and his foot was not agreeing with the turf. So again, now we've got third and about six. So now the decision is, do we want to sort of put it in Newcomb's hands and let him throw the ball a little bit and then maybe punt, just to give him that a little bit of that experience, or do we go for the first down? Because first down with a run play, 7 yards, that's a little harder. Especially with the type of offense that you have right now, where you have a lot more of your power guys in there, you know, maybe we just try to take a little shot and then give it to George, who can really boot the ball out. Looks like they've got Torrey Hicks running, and looks like he's going to get a first down and then some. And Hicks, as a good tantrum our Titan would, is always able to fight for that extra yard. Torrey is one of those ones. He's one of the tougher players I've ever taught or coached, and he's strong.
Yeah, he's not looking to take the sideline ever, and he demonstrated that he doesn't have to right there by bowling over a couple of the Ducks.
And it's funny, you look at Torrey, he's not a really large guy, but in high school he was actually an all-star offensive lineman, and now he's playing primarily slot, which he's normally played with the Mustangs since he began playing. So now again, the Mustangs were able to get a first down, and the Ducks, you know, really are, I think, are just hoping to kind of limit them to, you know, not much. Again, little throw, unfortunately a little bit over the head of Hicks, but that was a design play. It's just a straight dive, and then you have your slot running a little slant in there, and unfortunately it was just a little bit over his head, but that's a difficult one to complete as well.
Yeah, Hicks, that's the fourth attempt to get the ball to him through the air. You know, they got it to him on that counter, and he showed what he can do with it. I'm sure they'd love to get him a pass and
absolutely
get him in the open field.
And it is a tough one. Again, as we see, like in weather like this, it's really hard to kind of throw that ball well. And we can see it now on the field. The field is getting wetter and wetter. Again, you know, setting up to really block. Great little play action. Newcomb is just grabbing the ball, going to run as much as he can, and then steps out of bounds after the first down. Great downfield blocking by the receivers there, and Newcomb showing his speed and his athletic ability. Again, the reason why, when we saw Comfort in as quarterback, we saw Newcomb playing receiver. So obviously he's a multi-sport, sort of multi-talented athlete, has some really real good skill there. And again, it's flag on the play. I'm going to guess most likely a holding.
Yeah, it looks like they're going back 10. Newcomb on that one, he held the ball up long after, I'm pretty sure he knew he was going to run it. So showing a little bit of poise there and keeping the secondary off of him by holding the ball up like he's going to throw it.
Yeah, and it really did freeze that secondary because they knew they couldn't just step right up because he can throw it, and we've seen him be able to throw it. So, really good attempt there. So, again, we see, this is where penalties can cause problems sometimes. Again, getting the ball into the hands of Torrey Hicks. Great block by 87, Chris Brown. Hicks still running, trying to get every yard possible. The danger with that sometimes is that especially on a wet night like tonight.
Hicks running like I said, he's wanted to catch the ball and get in the open field. That time he got a handoff, got in the open field, and he was running with purpose there.
Torrey Hicks picks up 19.
So now we're seeing again, 5.5 minutes left. The Mustangs are really starting to move the ball a little bit. We see Evan Melanson coming back in. So coach might be wanting to talk to Josh LeBlanc, I believe, who he pulled out number 60, maybe just to give him a little bit of a break. Maybe he's running into some problems or seeing something. Anyway, it stands. All of a sudden now we have an offensive line there that is playing solidly. Now we see Newcomb under center, most likely going to be a quarterback sneak, and then some. Again, you have a super athletic. And now we know why they brought Melanson in. He's a guy that can pave the way pretty quickly.
Yeah, they want to make sure they brought Evan Melanson in because they wanted to get that push, knowing Newcomb was going to be in the mix there in that group. So they wanted to make sure that he was falling in the right direction and that he was safe. And
I don't think if at any point that's a slight to Josh LeBlanc at all. It's just Evan is a veteran, played at Mount A, has played with the Mustangs for several years, and has the size.
He's a star O-lineman, and not a slight at all against Josh. I think he's doing a good job in there. But if you got Evan in that situation, you're going to want to use him.
All right, so now the Mustangs are heading up again. We've got the trifecta of Purple Knights on the O-line, and you have Newcomb as a quarterback ready to throw the ball. It looks like, again, they're trying to set it up. Nice little throw, and just off the hands of Morris. Ellis, you can't throw the ball better than that. Unfortunately, it's sometimes we're thinking of running before we catch the ball, and I think that's sort of a little bit of what happened there. But it's always nice to tease Aubrey sometimes we make him running back because that way we don't have to throw to him too much. But at the same time, we've also seen him catch some really nice ones out of the backfield in the flat. So sometimes we just lose our focus a little bit on that one. But either way, it's still a good shot for the Mustangs. And they've got some nice sweep now again. And again, such a good run there. Again, it looks like Brady Morris on that one. He just runs and not hesitant at all, gets his foot into the dirt and makes that sort of that cut back and was able to get himself about another 5 or 6 yards there.
Yeah, the mark of a good running back at this level, right, is he's going to get tackled. He knows that. He sees the defender. He's going to make the most out of what he's got with that defender, and that's exactly what he did on that play.
So now again, it's one of those ones that we have to wonder, what do the Mustangs try to do here? Do they try to get just the 5 yards? Most likely. You can try a field goal, but we've had some problems with the snaps a little bit. So, just run the ball and we'll let Newcomb sort of throw it. Again, athletic quarterback is now given lots of speed. Great block by Aubrey Ellis. And Newcomb almost able to get down to, it looks like, about the 1 yard line, but great block set up by Ellis. So now we have 1 yard left, and now they have to decide. There is a player down, has taken a knee. Looks like one of our linemen. That one of the linemen that went down. I can't tell from here who it is. But it was one of the defensive linemen for the Ducks, so they're able to get him out of there. Again, may have been something as simple. He is limping a little bit, so it may have been sort of a tweaked ankle or hamstring. So now the Mustangs will set up on the 1 yard line, and then their decision has to be, do they want to give it to Newcomb, who has really gotten a lot of the yardage here, or do you want to hand it off to Morris, or do we want to try some sort of quick slant, because you're on the 1 yard line, so you have plenty of room. you know, there's lots of ways to work it around here.
Yeah, it's first down.
Again, Newcomb under center, so he's just, kind of sucked them in. Oh, nice defensive play. And the attempt was to Corey Lorette. So that was more just to have a little bit of fun, I think, and try to give it to the center. Oftentimes on those interior plays and those close plays, we always say, you know, the quick sneak is always sort of on the center. But it looks like Corey, again, is actually declaring. So he is playing tight end. So, again, we'll probably see Newcomb this time go for a sneak. And he's able to get across, and it is a touchdown. So, again, it was their attempt. They made the first one. The Ducks sniffed it out right away. They knew it was going for them, and they made a good play. They almost actually picked it off, but they actually made the smart play of just knocking it down. And then this time Newcomb behind, again, that massive Moncton offensive line was able to just slide through and get the touchdown. So now we're looking at a 54 or possibly 55 if they make the PAT.
Yeah, and minute 35 on the clock. It's counting down, so we're quickly approaching the end of the game.
Yeah, we're definitely in the home stretch, so we'll see again that sort of snap. Right to Newcomb as the holder, George as the kicker. And that was probably one of the cleanest snaps I've seen yet this game. You've got some good centers there.
Denis
Duero and Corey Lorette will both do long snapping duties, just depending on what it is. So we have some guys that are snapping really well, and that was a great, you know, clean catch there. So now we're less than a minute. Most likely we're going to see Moncton kick off, and we'll see. We'll most likely see the Ducks take a couple shots downfield, and then the game will be over. But overall, there are obviously some positives that the Ducks can take out of this. They know they have lots of work. Again, you know, they've had a couple rough games playing against the Island Mariners, who have some really good athletes last week, and then again against the Mustangs this week. So it's always one of those ones that with the MFL, it's not what you do in the first couple weeks, though. It's what you do in those last few weeks. So, you know, they've shown lots of growth and lots of improvement here, and there's lots of positives going away. And Lignos is one that I would have as sort of one of the stars of their game today. He has just played with such, like, power and purpose.
Absolutely. They showed some good things. We've talked about their special teams. They had a great great series with that. They capped off by that run by Lignos. You know, it's a first-year team. They've got some players that have experience in the MFL and at other levels as well. So it's a growing process for the rest of the team, and they've got to count on those veterans to.
And they've actually blown the game done. Looks like that was actually called by the Southern New Brunswick Ducks. Overall, you know, lots of improvement. Obviously, the Mustangs offense has shown how powerful and explosive they can be. We've seen how powerful and strong and locked down that the defense can be. But just like anything else, they always have room to move and room to improve.
Well, we've talked a lot about the Ducks, but the Mustangs have really shown a tremendous amount of weapons.
Yes.
You got three running backs that look great out there, and we couldn't see a lot from the receivers, but we did see Comfort playing well, and Newcomb came in and did a great job to wrap things up.
All right, so again, the score, 55 for Moncton Mustangs, 7 for the Southern New Brunswick Ducks. We'd like to thank everyone for watching, and for Bob Gifford and myself, Jason Agnew, we'd like to thank everyone again, and have a great night.